details and things that have to be worked on, but it does work pretty well. Injectables, the Haldol, Dilixin, Constant, Invega, Abilify, we have injectable forms of all of those. And Trenzia is one of the latest ones, that's every 3 months. So we've had a couple of people on that one. You get a shot like 4 times a year, good to go, if it works for you. Psychosocial treatments, patient and family psychoeducation, very important. Barbara had mentioned that I coordinate FPE for CNH, and that's what that is. It's family psychoeducation. We get together every 2 weeks and do what's called a problem-solving group. In the beginning, we do a workshop, which is providing education like this for families so that they understand the disease and know what works and what's helpful and what's not. Vocational training is also very important. Getting people back to work if that's what they were doing before, or helping them get a job if that's what they want. Social skills training, the clubhouse model, which is one of the programs we run at CMH, and that teaches people the work order day, gets them back into a routine and doing things. And then support groups like Schizophrenics Anonymous or one of the NAMI groups are very helpful. Taking care of the body is also helpful. Again, sleep, good nutrition, limiting substances, or not using them at all. Having a routine and exercising. Asking for help when needed. And keeping appointments and educating yourself. These are things that clients can control. They can control the fact that they got this disorder, but they can control some of these things. And it really does help. It helps the meds work better, it helps keep stress at bay, and that helps keep symptoms at bay. What doesn't help? Avoiding treatment. It happens all the time. Not recognizing the need for treatment. We call that lack of insight, or anosognosia. I put it in there just because I have to keep practicing that word because I can't say it. But it means not recognizing the need for treatment. And people don't very often. They're like, I'm not sick. I don't have anything wrong with me. I don't have any problems. You're making it all up. I don't have any symptoms. That can be an issue. It is a big issue. Neglecting physical health and using substances and living in high-stress environments. Stress is a major contributor to more relapse. So we try to keep their stress levels down and help them recognize how to deal with stress, and that helps with the symptoms. I want to mention co-occurring disorders. 60% of all the people, probably more than 60% of all the people with a severe mental illness also abuse substances. And for schizophrenia, it can be a pretty significant factor in whether or not they're going to have acute episodes again. These are some of the commonly abused substances. This isn't going to come as a surprise to anybody. Alcohol, marijuana, heroin we're seeing an uptick in big time. Prescription meds, particularly the opiates. Marijuana is going to be a big problem next year. We have a new law coming out in December, and that's going to really increase the amount of marijuana that's produced in certain counties, if the counties allow it, or the townships, I should say, if the townships allow it. So I expect to see that become more of a problem. And it's very often the drug of choice for people with thought disorder, for whatever reason. Unfortunately, for people with thought disorders, substances can increase and even bring about psychotic episodes, and in particular, the hallucinogens, the acid, and marijuana. When we see people using that, then we know we're likely to see an increase of symptoms, and particularly the psychotic symptoms. I put nicotine on there because it is one of the most abused substances, and for people with severe mental illness, there's a high rate of smokers, much more so than in the regular population, or the typical population. You can see that with schizophrenia, they're the highest users of cigarettes among people with severe mental illness. And then, but it's still pretty high in all of the other disorders as well. And when I say smoke, I mean, I'm talking like 1, 2, 3, 4 packs of cigarettes a day. We have some homes where you just literally, you should wear a mask because it is just so smoky, it's so, it's dangerous for the workers, really. I had one client and I would sit in her kitchen and it was like a cloud and it just wafted from the living room and yeah, she has some serious emphysema right now. But the problem with this is that this is one of the biggest contributors to people with severe mental illness dying so early. It really does shorten their life. But the research shows, for whatever reason, the nicotine seems to help people feel better when they have certain mental health conditions, and schizophrenia is one of them. So it's hard to convince people to stop smoking, although they would say, they often say, I want to quit smoking, I can't breathe. So we try to help them do that. We're going to actually focus on that more over the next year.
Question?
Yes.
So if nicotine helps with the feelings of the mental illness and the smoking is what's so dangerous, are other delivery systems of nicotine helpful as a substitute?
Right. We do have some people that switch to the vaping, and they vape a lot too. I mean, but the evidence is still out on whether or not that's better physically for you, so we're not really sure. And I don't know exactly what it is about the nicotine that helps people. It might be that it helps them focus a little bit better.
Well, it does. Nicotine does help them focus.
Right. Yep. Because we see a higher rate with people with ADHD as well. They tend to smoke more and stuff.
Yeah, it does reduce stress. People say it reduces stress.
Yep.
Is the use of tobacco, is that a recent thing?
No.
Going on for a long time.
It has. Yep. It's not new. It's just becoming more of a focus for people in the mental health field to try and get people to quit, to preserve their health, because, like I said, it's one of the contributing factors for the early death among people with severe mental illness. They just end up getting conditions like emphysema and COPD and things like that.
What about, because I know with the ADD and the ADHD, some of those drugs that are prescribed to speed it up, does it go along with that, with schizophrenia
If somebody with schizophrenia uses stimulants, which is what an Adderall or a Concerta is,
cigarette smoke, I mean, that's an upper too.
Right. Right, yeah, it is a mild stimulant.
That's what I'm getting. It's like some kind of stimulant that be added to the...
It might be to counteract kind of those negative symptoms, that not wanting to do anything and not having a lot of initiative. I've seen it as more of an obsessive kind of behavior. Like it's chain smoking. Maybe something to do or something to occupy your time. It's hard to say what it is exactly. But if I do see somebody with schizophrenia abusing Adderall, it's not a good thing. That's not going to work out very well. That's going to push more of those psychotic symptoms, for sure. So I guess tobacco doesn't do it as much.
Where would you put alcohol?
Alcohol is still our most commonly abused substance because it's so widely available. So it is, there's a high rate of alcohol use among the SMI population.
How do they refer to it? Do they say it helps? It says it calms them down?
Generally calms them down, it helps me sleep, I forget about things for a little while, and that's all true. Unfortunately, the next day things are worse, because alcohol, even in somebody without schizophrenia, increases anxiety, and it disturbs sleep, it, you know, interferes with cognition, so it's a short-term, solution.
What about caffeine, like in Diet Cokes and coffee?
Oh my gosh, I have to add caffeine to
that
slide.
I know, I wonder why I wasn't up there, actually.
Yeah, I drink 4 2-liters of Coke a day. I'm like, oh my gosh, that's a lot of Coke to drink. That's a lot of sugar and that's a lot of caffeine. Pots and pots of coffee. Again, like trying to, in a sense, like you were saying, to try and start that, yes, exactly. Yeah, we can all usually take like 1 or 2 cups in the morning, but 4 pots, that might be a little bit much.
Yeah.
And it interferes with sleep. We've actually had people start using that heavily, and then it can lead to an acute episode because they're using so much caffeine, they cannot bring themselves down. How does recovery from dual disorder occur? They both need to be addressed equally. The old school of thought was, if you have substance abuse and you have a mental illness, we're going to treat this one first, and then you can come over. So go and get your substance abuse taken care of, and then come over here and we'll treat your mental illness, or vice versa. That does not work at all. We've learned from hard lessons. So on the mental health side, nearly all of the therapists and case managers that are working at CMH right now have not only training in social work or psychology, but also are certified alcohol and drug counselors. Because we recognize that it doesn't work to just do one thing, so they have to address both. And with the ACT team, they have even extra training. They have something called integrated dual disorder treatment. And people with severe substance use disorder and severe mental illness go on that team for very intensive services and try to address both things. They get frequent contacts. We're using medication-assisted treatment more often for people with opioid use disorder or alcohol use disorder. And these are medications that decrease cravings, replace the effect of the drug so that they can function a little bit better. It really has helped a lot of people. Treatment can involve residential stays, detox, outpatient services, support groups. We have a recovery coach on ACT who is a former substance use disorder client, and he's recovered now. He's in recovery, and he will help people go to AA meetings. He'll talk to them about his story with substance addiction, and that peer contact is very helpful for a lot of folks struggling with this disorder. But recovery, again, takes time. There's hope, there's courage, but for most people, recovery occurs over time. Schizophrenia and violence. People always ask me, are people with schizophrenia violent? They're still more likely to hurt themselves than to hurt anybody else. The biggest predictor of violence, whether you have schizophrenia,